Let's move on and talk about the law of supply. What does it actually mean for a firm to supply a good or service? Three criteria must be met. Firstly, the firm must have the resources and technology to produce it. The resources and technology available to a firm act as a constraint on how much it can produce. The firm must be able to make a profit, or at least break even, from supplying the good. If it makes losses from producing a good, then there's no incentive to do so. The firm must also plan to produce and sell this good. If all these criteria are met, then we can say that the firm supplies a good or service. The quantity supplied of a good or service is the amount that the producers plan to sell during a given period at a given price. Keep in mind that the quantity supplied is not necessarily the same as the quantity sold. We'll learn why this is the case when we study equilibrium theory in the next lecture, but for now just know that the quantity sold to end consumers and the quantity supplied by firms are not always the same thing. The law of supply describes the positive relationship between the price and the quantity supplied of a good or service. Essentially, this means that as price increases, the quantity supplied of a good increases, and that as price decreases, the quantity supplied of a good decreases. Both price and quantity supplied move in the same direction. You might be wondering why increases in prices cause increases in the quantity supplied. Can't firms just increase the quantity at any price to increase their profit margins? Well, not really. The incremental cost required to produce an additional unit, or the marginal cost of an additional unit, increases. Think about it this way. If a factory wants to increase its output in the short run, the only factor of production that it can change to do so is labor. As more and more people work in this factory, each worker has a smaller and smaller work area, making it harder for them to produce an additional unit of the good. Thus, they need to work longer hours to make the same good. This means that you will be paying them more to make the same good. Thus, the cost of producing an additional unit of the good goes up. Companies want to at least cover the costs of production. Therefore, the market price must equal the cost of production for the company to even think about producing the good. And this is why the quantity supplied of a good or service increases as the price of that good increases. The supply curve is just a graphical representation of the entire relationship between the price of a good and its quantity supplied. We can determine the quantity supplied at any given price by simply taking a point on the curve and checking the price and quantity that correspond with that point. We can interpret the supply curve as a minimum supply price curve. This essentially describes a curve that shows the lowest price at which firms are willing to sell an additional unit of a good. We just talked about how the marginal cost of production increases as we produce a greater quantity, and so the company wants to cover at least its cost of production, if not make a profit on top of that, for each good that it produces. Thus, the supply curve shows us the price required to induce a firm to produce each given quantity of that good. Just as we saw in the lecture about demand theory, we can observe shifts in the supply curve as well. We say that supply changes when any factor that influences selling plans, of course other than price, changes. This causes the quantity supplied at any given price to either increase or decrease depending on what the situation is. Note that when we say that supply has increased, we shift the curve down and to the right, and when we say that supply has decreased, we shift the curve up and to the left. The first factor that affects supply is the prices of factors of production. In order to think about this intuitively, let's consider the supply curve as the minimum supply price curve again. If the price of labor, for example, increases, then the firm spends more on each unit produced and thus would require a higher selling price to induce it to supply more of a given good. Thus, the supply curve would shift up and to the left. In the same way, if the price of a factor of production decreased, then supply would increase and the curve would shift down and to the right. Just as a side note, from now on I'll just say that the supply curve shifts to the left and or right, even though I really mean up and to the left or down and to the right. It's just easier to say. The second factor that can influence supply as a whole is the prices of complements and substitutes in production. Complements in production are two goods that can be produced together. As an example, let's consider beef and cow hides. Both beef and cow hides come from cows. Let's say that we're looking at the market for beef and we are told that the price of cow hides just went up. If this is the case, then the quantity supplied of cow hides would increase. In essence, more cows are being killed for their cow hides. Excuse the imagery, but now we have all these dead cows lying around, so firms use them to produce beef. Essentially, the supply of beef has increased because the price of cow hides has increased. It works both ways. If the price of cow hides were to fall, then the supply of beef would fall, thus shifting the curve to the left. Substitutes in production are goods that can be produced by using the same resources. Think about energy drinks and energy bars. A firm has to split up its resources between energy drinks and energy bars. It's not like cowhide and beef where both goods come from the same cow. If the price of energy drinks increases, then the firm wants to increase its quantity supplied of energy drinks. Thus, it will reduce the supply of energy bars and use those resources to produce energy drinks. In this case, the supply of energy bars shift to the left. It works both ways. If the price of energy drinks decreases, then the supply of energy bars would increase. Expected future prices should be pretty intuitive. If I, as a firm, expect to earn more in the future from selling a good, then I would hold off on selling right now and sell my goods in the future instead at higher prices. Thus, today the supply of the good would decrease. Conversely, if the expected future price of a good fell, then the supply of that good today would increase. Firms would rather sell the good today when its price is higher to make greater profits. The number of suppliers should also be quite intuitive. If we have more firms producing the good, then regardless of what the price is, we have a greater quantity produced. Thus, as the number of suppliers increases, so does the supply. If the number of suppliers decreases, then the supply of the good decreases. Technology is a factor which doesn't really ever decrease supply, rather it almost always increases it. If some new technology is developed which makes a firm more efficient at producing a good, then it can supply more of that good with a given quantity of resources, effectively reducing its cost of production. Thus, supply would increase. We need to keep in mind the difference between the quantity supplied of a good and its entire supply. When we say that the quantity supplied has changed, we are referring to a movement along the supply curve. This can only be induced by a change in the price of that good. When we refer to a change in supply, we are talking about a shift of the entire curve. A shift of the entire supply curve represents a change in the quantity supplied at all possible prices and is caused by the factors that we discussed in the previous slide.